It is 11:31 and people may still be entering, but it's time to start our virtual Grand Rounds. So welcome to our virtual Nursing Grand Rounds series. I just want to make sure I have the right document in front of me. So again, welcome everybody. My name is Nikki Goodwin, Associate Dean for Clinical Practice, and I'll be introducing our very special guest today. My co-hosts are Dr. Diana Baptiste and Katie Damaroda from Alumni Relations. First, just a few logistics. This session is being recorded. To receive a CNE unit, you must remain on the entire session and respond to an evaluation via email at the end. Questions or comments may be entered into the chat box at any time and will be monitored and addressed at the end of the presentation. Today's guest may need no introduction, but she is going to get one. Patricia Davidson has been our beloved dean and professor at the School of Nursing for almost 8 years. And today we are honored to host her farewell lecture as she is about to return home to her alma mater in Australia as their new vice chancellor. She will also be with her lovely family again. And for both these reasons, we must say goodbye, at least for now. Dean Davidson has achieved so much in her time here, from being everyone's greatest advocate to securing a most beautiful new building, from leading global health to giving local vaccinations, and from building new programs to ensuring everyone's well-being is at the forefront. Her achievements are seemingly limitless. She is an outstanding cardiovascular nurse and scientist. She has published profusely. She teaches across the curriculum. And she has never let go of the fact that she is proud to be a nurse. Her awards, prizes, and accolades are many, and I encourage you to read her bio. But her recognition across the globe, she's perhaps best known for her commitment to diversity, equity, and inclusion, which is just part of her MO and will follow her wherever she goes. She walks the walk in excellence while demonstrating humility and kindness in her leadership. There is so much more to say, but I think we would all rather have Trish talk to us and present her farewell lecture entitled Life is a Series of Handoffs. So it is my very distinct pleasure to introduce Dean Patricia Davidson.
So thanks so much, Mickey and Diana and Katie for organizing today's session, and also Rafe and Florentina and Matt behind the scenes. This is a very special day for me and also very emotional. And I really thank you for being here today. And can everyone see my screen?
Not yet, Trish.
Not yet.
If I share, see, I'm nervous. If I shared my screen, it would work. Okay. Clearly. Chew gum. So today, thanks for being with me. And what I would like to think about is a handoff to you and to the school and to the future leadership. And I really think as we develop and grow across our leadership trajectory and as a nurse, you know, life is full of handoffs, and we have them personally, professionally, but also a handoff marks a point of transition. And so it's very emotional, it's very impactful, and it's very important. So what is a handoff? And I've learned something today, because Mickey will agree, in our part of the world, we call them handovers, not handoffs. And so I thought, oh, look, I better know what I'm talking about. So I didn't know that it's an American football term to hand the ball to a nearby teammate on a play. And I really think that is what I would love to achieve today. Firstly, to thank you for supporting me in my leadership, implore you to keep Hopkins moving forward, as I know you will, and to really, for particularly the students, to think about looking back at what their career might look like. Dream big, think big, and you never know where you're going to end up. And I'd also like to dedicate today's talk to the thousands of nurses and physicians and other healthcare providers who have worked tirelessly in the pandemic, and also sort of recognize the lives that have been lost senselessly during this pandemic. So Hopkins is an amazing place, and I'm not telling you anything that you don't know. And the School of Nursing is very distinctive, and this is not necessarily talked about widely around the halls of Johns Hopkins, but the man Johns Hopkins instructed his trustees to establish a nursing school to benefit the community and to serve the community with trained and competent nurses. And we all know that there is questions now around the history of Johns Hopkins, the man, but history will judge us all in very different ways. And for whatever happened, we have to thank him for having the vision to know that a hospital is nothing without nurses, and also a vision for the community. So Isabel Hampton Robb was the first superintendent of the School of Nursing. And she set the school on this amazing trajectory. And she surrounded herself by smart, intelligent women, Anna Wolf, Lavinia Dock, Elsie Lawler, many others, who set the School of Nursing on a different sort of trajectory. And we have to think about the history of the times, and that Florence Nightingale really was initiating contemporary nursing as we know it. In fact, as we look at different versions of nursing around the world, in fact, the first formal nurse was documented in the times of Muhammad. But certainly Florence Nightingale signaled us into a new era. And she was a great supporter of Isabel Hampton Robb, and in fact sent her wedding bouquet. But Isabel Hampton Robb set us on a trajectory, because it was just not about nurses being kind. It was about nurses being smart. And she actually advocated for nurses learning different languages. And she really didn't mince words about what our mission was. She said, nurses are trusted with the most precious thing on earth, the life, health, and happiness of other human beings. And that is a really powerful call to action. But this was the image of nurses of the time. And often nursing is described as kind of born in the convent, raised in, which refers to sometimes the paradox of values that we express. And so this is where I went to nursing school, and this is actually the graduating class. Now, to many people, that's pretty amazing, but that's what nursing was like in the English model. And Australia is a colony of the United Kingdom. And then, so it was a very different world. And hospitals were always on the hill. This is the hospital where I started my nursing career as a diploma nurse. And like the many alumni who went through the diploma nurse programs at Hopkins, it was a very rigorous program, and we learned a lot, and we were committed to making the world a better place. But the world goes on, qualifications evolve, and so has healthcare. I'm often chastened by what I have seen over my nursing career from introduction of thrombolytic therapy, percutaneous coronary intervention. Many of these therapies were not around when I started nursing. And in fact, where I started in cardiology, which has been my real love, it was not unusual for five people to die on a shift. And they were, majority of them were men in their 50s. So we have a lot to celebrate about science and the development and evolution of our beloved profession, nursing. And we have a lot to be thankful for. And certainly the COVID-19 pandemic and the rapid introduction of the vaccine is another reason for us to commit to a life of science. So in a handoff, often we want to tell the incoming shift or the person coming, you know, what are some of the trends that they should be thinking about in the patient's clinical status? But also I want our school to think about some of the trends on the horizon. And we already have many leaders in this space who think about healthcare beyond the confines of the hospital wall. But that's a really important place to be for nurses of the future. So the American Association of Colleges of Nursing has done a lot of thinking about academic nursing, how we create this interface between the academy and the clinical setting. And in fact, that was the reason for creating Dr. Goodwin's role as Associate Dean for Clinical Practice. We have to embrace a new vision of academic nursing. We have to think about the communities. This is one of my favourite photos that has been pinned upon above my desk. And you'll recognise Dr. Phyllis Sharps and her work at Henderson Hopkins, and Lucine Francis is following her in those footsteps. We have to think about a different conceptual framework for how we practice and how, importantly, in a school of nursing, we educate nurses. Yesterday, the Affordable Care Act was 11 years old. And regardless of implementation, that is the best thing that has ever happened in the context of the US health system to really shift the needle towards more equity. But what I want you to also think about, and our amazing faculty, staff, and students are already embedded in these different dimensions. So it's not just about providing care to people who are sick, it's promoting health, it's being innovative, it's engaging with the community, and also working to make sure that in policy that our innovations are implemented. And we see this with the work of Sarah Zanton, where the Capable Project has been named by President Biden in his policies. We see Dr. Jackie Campbell advancing violence against women legislation for protection. And we see people like Nancy Glass who are really doing local to global work, particularly to address gender equity. So beyond thinking about healthcare as being much more than beyond the hospital walls, we have to think about what is the reality for the future. And it's great in our school, we have a P30 that focuses on multimorbidity, but this is going to be the future. The fastest growing segment of the population in many parts of the world are centenarians, of which we know very little about. And if we're really wanting to age in a healthy way and make sure that people are valued and productive, we have to think about different things. So maybe in the working life of a nurse, which is for 40 odd years, maybe people like me won't exist that are cardiovascular nurses, because we know that there is a lot more to the body than a single organ. The other thing that I think will be really important to think about is value-based healthcare, which is the essence of the Affordable Care Act. We have to move beyond fee-for-service models. We have to look at the integration of health and social care. And we have to think about access. And so these are going to be different conversations that our students will be having as they progress across their career. And also measuring quality is in itself a very complex conversation, but is important for us to consider and understand. And also we need to recognise that just throwing money at it doesn't make a difference. And we've seen this in the context of chronic and complex care and all across the world, these are data from Kaiser Permanente model, that 6% of people with multiple chronic conditions consume 33% of the healthcare budget. Now, if this made people better and decreased their suffering, maybe we could live with it. But in essence, that is not the case. We know that many people coming into the hospital, not only does it not relieve symptoms, but also exposes them to many other risks. So we really have to think about care in the community. And we see some really phenomenal models here in our community and in our great city. But we really need to think about team-based healthcare. And so I'm really excited to see so many more non-nursing faculty with us in our school, Dr. Eric Slade, Dr. Nancy Perrin, Dr. Shapra Budathoki, and many others, because healthcare is a team sport. And this brings me back to my analogy of a handoff. You know, how do we configure a team that is around supporting the needs of the individual and the families and communities, and not about making money for individual providers or healthcare systems? And so one of the things that I'm sure in my handoff, I really want to encourage and motivate and inspire people to work more and more in interdisciplinary teams. We see some of the great work that happens in the interprofessional education sector, and you know, Ibi Tanner has done a fabulous job in laying groundwork, and Nicole Molenkoff, a pharmacist, is taking us to another level. And within our research teams, you know, multidisciplinary collaboration is kind of a given, but we really need to work better at that in our academic programs. And because, as this cartoon says, how can they work together if they don't learn together? And if we don't speak the same language, how can we be effective as a team? How can we hand off the ball to the right player if we don't understand what that individual is doing? So now we want to shift gear and get us to think a little bit more about nursing. And this is a slide, and it reads, if ever there was a profession called into the existence by the real needs of humanity, it's nursing. No one will dispute this. Yet it is true that if ever a profession had to contend with misunderstanding, misrepresentation, antagonism, and exploitation, it is nursing. And we've seen this in the context of the pandemic. Now, this was written in 1917. But in many, many ways, not a whole lot has changed. And in the context of the pandemic, many nurses have felt vilified and blamed for a whole range of patient outcomes that are not their fault. There's also been vociferous criticism of nursing schools where we have not adequately prepared nurses for the pandemic. Now, I can tell you, I don't think anybody was prepared for this pandemic. But a lack of what is perceived as curriculum content is nothing in parallel to the lack of systems and processes around the world that have failed to protect both nurses, patients, families, and communities. So our image really matters. And I'm going to go through these slides really quickly because I've got a lot to say. And so I really, a big shout out to our marketing and communications team at Hopkins, who have done such a great job in curating our story. Thanks also to Chris Godak, who helps me in thinking about how we tell a better story, a better narrative about our profession. Because there is still a lot of misrepresentation and misunderstanding, and we have to change that. And as leaders at Hopkins, it is our responsibility. So if we look at the images of nursing, they're diverse and and often incongruous. The way we portrayed in the media has a negative effect on how people see us and also how we perceive ourselves. So these are kind of the stereotypes of nursing, which are very gender-based. And if you just put into images of nursing, this is what pops up. So no one actually really sees what is the work of nurses. Yes, we are very kind and very nice most of the time, But we are also really smart and do very technical things and very complex things. But where are those images? And so we at the School of Nursing, I'm really proud of that we got this campaign, which sort of starred many of our faculty and students, our attempts to address gender norms, and also, you know, what is the future of nursing? How are we going to be positioned in the new world? And this is, I hope, is going to be the future of nursing. This is the Black Student Nurses Association here at our school. We need to move forward. We need to make sure that the populations that we take care of are represented in the students in our school. So these issues around professionalization of nursing have been around for a long time. But COVID-19 has pulled back the curtains and laid wide bare the cracks in our society and also some of the difficult issues in our profession and which we have to reckon with. And so we're never going to address structural racism and structural issues unless we look at our history and our structures. So the hospital on the hill model, that expert model, is not going to work in the future. So building big buildings, getting people to come to them is not the future. It's about us embedded in communities. And in spite of the fact that even during the pandemic, the United States has thrown billions of dollars at COVID, the health outcomes are really devastating, as we've seen multiple deaths and many preventable infections. So we've also got to think about these structures and the history that we know. So we know that Florence Nightingale, as I mentioned, set forward this contemporary model of healthcare. And it was not just nursing. It was largely the professionalization of medicine as well, which took us to these sort of buildings. But, you know, for many of Florence's negative attributes, particularly on her views around colonialism and Indigenous people, she was kind of visionary in that she saw this intersection between health and the environment. And even though she didn't quite get it right, whenever I see this photo, I think of Marie Nolan, and she loves to have our windows open when we ever have a flu outbreak. And even though you know, miasma is not the reason for infectious diseases. Certainly we've learnt in COVID that many of these hypotheses, particularly in airflow, have been substantiated in rigorous experiments. But we have to really recast our history. We have to value what Florence achieved. Yes, the first statistician, and really set us on a pathway for nursing science. But we also have to think about what this history of colonialism and this notion of whiteness in our nursing profession has done to society and healthcare. And not only has 2020 been to 21 been the pandemic, it's also seen these just horrendous, really, and tragic murders of people who, for no reason other than just being Black, have been exposed to violence and death and suffering. And so this is making us all look deeper. And to be honest, you know, my viewing of Florence Nightingale before I actually went back this year to look at a whole lot of texts was much a sanitized view. So I think the COVID-19 pandemic has got us all to stop and think. And can I tell you, for the first time in my nursing career, there have been times when we have not known what to do. I always remember a very dark day when I went to the CDC website and I felt myself saying, can I trust this information? To me, that was probably one of the darkest days of the pandemic, because all around the world, you know, I grew up in Australia, people look to the United States as a beacon of knowledge and science and credibility. And yet we really went through this dark period where science was threatened. So we're all in the midst of a very deep reckoning of society, healthcare, and also nurses. We have to think about our profession. But look, this isn't new to any of us, because we've known it doesn't matter if you work in mental health, if you work in cardiology, if you work in OBGYN, poverty, access to care, environmental exposure, and racism, that is, social determinants of health, are the predictors of adverse health outcomes. And many of us have worked in institutions where it's easier to get a stem cell transplant than to get an effective discharge plan. So as nurse leaders, as driving healthcare, we have to flip the dial. We have to change the direction, and we have to emphasize the importance of the science that we do. This is just as important as genomics, and we have to make sure that bodies of knowledge are not privileged over another. And this was a very impactful paper to me. And in fact, one of our faculty, Cheryl Dennison Himmelfarb, was an author. And, you know, that's one thing about sort of being in healthcare a long time, things change. And I read this paper with great interest, looking at social determinants of risk and outcomes for cardiovascular disease. Because if I'd said to a cardiologist when I started working in coronary care in the 1980s that depression, anxiety, social isolation would be adverse health outcomes, he would have looked at me like I was crazy, because our image of healthcare, our image of what was cardiovascular disease, was all around middle-aged white men. So this, as in my handoff to you, particularly our students, be open, things change, and we have to deal with change and deal with that change with humility as well. So the images of Florence Nightingale, we can value where she got us, but that is not the future of our work. These pictures of, you know, white women around the leader, it are not the future. And so we in Baltimore have a lot of introspection to do. We know what has happened in the past, and we have to acknowledge that past and recognize what has happened, but we also need to move forward, but within a spirit of reconciliation and restoration. And we have to make sure that the images that we see are not just what I've seen of Florence Nightingale, but like here, some of the phenomenal African-American nurses who have really led the way from Harriet Tubman to the future. And here we have Gertrude Hodges here, who was up, even though the School of Nursing opened in 1889, it was only in the 1950s that African-Americans were admitted to the school. And she was the first African-American. And I also acknowledge the pioneering work of Fanny Gaston Johansson, the first tenured professor at Johns Hopkins, who is in our school. And also the great work of Phyllis Sharps, because many of these people are the first, and we have to make it easier so that there is many more following them. So even in the context of this challenge, it's an important time for nursing and midwifery around the world. We are really being recognised for what the work that we do, the science that we do, but we have to make sure that we're at decision-making tables. And if we look at where we're at in terms of global health, we're in this unfinished agenda of high rates of avertable infectious diseases, and also high maternal child mortality. We all know that the maternal child mortality in the United States is really something that should be and is a source of shame in the richest country in the world. We know that the population is aging and there's many more chronic conditions. And we know from well-conducted studies that just spending money doesn't actually improve health outcomes. And so we need to look at cost and value. And that's where I think lots of our work is going to be, is determining what is the value proposition of nursing to healthcare. So the other thing I'm going to challenge you about in my handoff is just now as we pivot from the evidence-based practice agenda. And this is, and the reason why is that even though that evidence-based practice we know is really important, is that people often forget that there are three items to Sackett et al.'s definition of evidence-based practice. The first one is the best available evidence focusing on efficacy. The second is clinical expertise within the context of patients' condition and the risks and benefits of treatment. And also, really importantly, is client preferences and values. And how do we find out about them? We ask people. So unfortunately, in places in academic health science centres, many people just focus on efficacy. And just because you can do something doesn't mean that you need to do something. So really where we're at is implement the era of implementation science. We can't just be saying in talks all the time is there's a 17-year time from discovery to implementation. We really need to look at a whole range of knowledge translation, exchange, transfer activities that are very based in theoretical premises and also in behaviour change. And so this, in my handoff to you, is something that I think each and every one of us should embrace and learn a lot more about. But, you know, why is it harder in nursing to demonstrate our value proposition? So Albert Einstein, you know, the one of the greatest empiricists, writes, not everything that counts can be counted, and not everything that can be counted counts. So this is where we often find ourselves entangled in nursing, debating the difference between quantitative and qualitative methods, where we talk about the difference between the art and the science of nursing. But I firmly believe in my handoff that nursing is a STEM discipline. And what people talk about art and the science as two very distinct perspectives, but I think that is what is encapsulated in expert clinical practice. That is an educated, intelligent, curious, and resourceful nurse who is both empathetic and caring. And that is what I think is a Hopkins nurse. And that's what has fueled me every day I've been here, just to see the great work that people do. What we have to do better is to be able to kind of get that recipe right. What is it about our education? What it is about the environment that creates these exceptional nurses? So we also have to think about where we're at in terms of the exposure of nurses within the context of the COVID-19 pandemic. And we've kind of waxed and waned. And many people say, look, no more clapping, no more tin banging. Respect me, engage me, and make sure that I'm recognised for the work that I do and I'm protected. So we're very fortunate at the moment within the global sector to have a director general who believes in nurses. And he says that nurses play a critical role, not just in terms of delivering direct healthcare, but in transforming health policies, promoting health in communities, and supporting patients and families. So I take you back to the model of the contemporary academic health science centre, where in my handoff to you, I implore you to be more powerful and passionate in advocacy. And we're also fortunate to have Elizabeth Iroh, who is the first CNO for the WHO in many decades. And she says that nurses and midwives are already leaders in delivering care. The next step is to make them at the heart of policy making. Now, over these next two slides, I'm just going to show you some images, which to me, a picture says a thousand words. You know, a lot of this is rhetorical. We know that in global health, women do 70 to 80% of the work, but around probably 10% of the decision-making tables. And in many healthcare settings, that is still the same. And so, as you can see, this was a WHO, UNICEF, World Bank event for universal healthcare coverage. You know, one woman. And more importantly, if you look at the International Monetary Fund meeting last year in or year or so in Washington, being powerful often means having the checkbook. And without money, there is no mission. So thinking about how we get to decision-making tables is really important. How we empower each other, how we sponsor each other, how when we get there, we send the elevator down to pick up the next person. And that's one of the reasons that I'm really excited about our Doctor of Nursing Practice MBA program, with the first class graduating this year, that hopefully we are going to make a difference in that setting. And also, I really want us to have greater representation. Some of you might may have remembered this day. This was when previous President Trump was hospitalized with COVID-19. And you know, we saw these press conferences. And I remember this day vividly because someone in the press gallery asked, what was the president's oxygenation overnight? And the physician said, well, I'll have to ask the nurses. But we know what has really made a difference for a lot of people in the context of COVID-19 has been diligent nursing care, the monitoring of oxygenation positioning. So when are we ever going to be at that decision-making table entirely? And we know that even in the transition task force for COVID-19, it was only after a lot of agitation that a nurse was added to the COVID-19 task force. So how do we seize our power? And here is Jason Farley, who has been really done a phenomenal work in the context of COVID-19. He received the Courage Award from the American Academy of Nursing for his innovation. And has also been in every media channel discussing the value and the role of nursing. And the State of the World's Nursing Report has provided us with a roadmap. And Dr. Nancy Reynolds was integrally involved in this report. And this gives us a roadmap moving forward. But a big part of that is leadership, advocacy, and our roles in policy. And so that can be just as important, particularly for a school like Hopkins, as knowing what a left anterior hemi block is or things like that. But being able to make a difference sometimes is around advocacy and policy. And as we hand over, we have to think about healthcare as an ecosystem, that healthcare happens on a global level. And COVID-19 has told us that. And so we can't just be focusing on the individual patient or nurse if we're really going to move healthcare outcomes forward. And this is why the Sustainable Development Goals are such an important roadmap for the world. And even though many healthcare providers zero in on three, good health, we know without peace and justice, without gender equality, without eradicating poverty, without having a healthy environment, doesn't matter if you can put in an implantable defibrillator or you can do a stem cell transplant or you can do chemotherapy. None of these things matter within the context of a broader, healthier planet. So this will be familiar to all of my students who I'm always trying to encourage them to say that if you really want to do person-centered care, you need to interface policy, practice, education, and research. One of the amazing examples that I've seen is Nancy Glass's work in the Congo, where she is looking at microfinancing and empowering women and getting kids in school, a whole of community approach. So we have to make sure that our research is relevant to patients, to individuals and families and communities, and not just what we want to do. So that means thinking about what happens in communities and being able to navigate those systems. And then also I'm going to bring us back to Florence, because she did sort of set a pretty good roadmap in terms of patient quality and safety and the environment. But we just have to take that agenda forward to make sure it's inclusive and respectful and recognises the ills that have happened in the past. But, you know, there's so many things that her words speak to me. I think one's feelings waste themselves in words. They ought to be distilled into actions which bring results. And I think that's why nurses are so powerful. We just don't talk about doing things. We actually do things that bring comfort and support. One of the other things that I'd really like to do in handoff to you is to untap what this means to be the most trusted profession. And I really encourage you to read this article by Chris Love, which was in Forbes last year. And he's the president of Pace University in New York and is actually from a business school background. And he is sort of saying, you know, these results as nurses being the most trusted profession are pretty phenomenal. And ask the question, should empathy, reliability, and advocacy be placed at the center of other professionals' training? So we've got this. We've nailed this. For over 20 years, people have said we're the most trusted profession. And we often say that, like, of course we're nurses, we're nice and we're trusted. But what is it about us? And I think we really need to be able to tell that story in a much better way. And also, it's a very, very powerful trait. So I just want to leave you with a couple of thoughts. And I really want you to go and read this book. It's called The Great Influencer, and it's all John Barry wrote this, and a lot of it is about Hopkins, and you really understand the role that Hopkins has played in infectious diseases. But there are the same errors in the 1918 pandemic that we see today. Misinformation, poor leadership, lack of transparency. But in 2005, Barry wrote, "Nursing could give the victim of the disease the best possible chance to survive. Nursing could save lives." And we can say that even in this current pandemic, as the multiple studies come out, it will be around nursing patient staffing, around leadership, around the education of nurses that are going to play out. And also something additionally impactful, this is a quote from Nadia Andrade, who is one of our PhD students. And Nadia has worked with MSF for many years in Serbia, Bosnia, and other places, and also Syria. And she found her deployment to New York in the current COVID pandemic to be one of the most challenging. And she says, "An intensive care bed without a nurse is just another place of suffering." So what is it, the work that we do? It's not that just we go to work every day and stand by a bed, or we just don't go into the community, into a school and stand in a room. How do we really articulate the work that we do? And we need to get better at explaining that. And so moving forward, you know, as I hand off to you, I think, and I wrote this for our 130th anniversary because I refuse to believe that nursing has not been going since 1889 at Johns Hopkins. Yes, it was punctuated for political reasons, which are all about money, sex, and power. But due to phenomenal women, in 1984, nursing was reestablished at Johns Hopkins. And look where we are now. So we need to commemorate the nursing legacy that has strengthened us in the past, but we also need to focus on the future work that we have to do so desperately to improve the well-being of communities around the world. And this starts by never forgetting what has happened in this pandemic. And even as people go off to spring break and people have a sense that life is kind of returning to normal, still, 1,000 people a day are dying in the United States from COVID-19, from a preventable condition. That's pretty deplorable. And so we can't normalize this death and suffering, particularly in those who are really the most vulnerable in society. And yesterday, and over the last week, we've seen just again the agony associated with gun violence, which is another epidemic in society. We cannot ignore those factors. So handing off to you, I think we're going to be in a much more technological world. We know telehealth is here to stay. And I love this photo as an old intensive care nurse, you know, going to a storeroom and you expect to see IV pumps and things. And I love this photo because it's just full of iPads. So things are going to be different. We're going to be learning differently. We're going to be communicating differently with patients. And so we need to become much more digitally agile. But as a leading school of nursing, you know, in my handoff, you know, we need to recognize the trauma and atrocities of the past. We can't move forward unless we recognize that. We need to prioritize social determinants of health, whether you're in the emergency department, the delivery suite, or working in the community. We cannot shy away from politics because healthcare is intrinsically political. We cannot stand back and see people die needlessly. We cannot stand back and see this pandemic of gun violence go on unchecked, untested. And as we think about healthcare, not just in public health, but we have to be much more collaborative. It's much more about us and not them. So I'm handing off, and even though I've mentioned the beginning of Hopkins Nursing with Isabel Hampton Robb, since 1984, there's been some formidable deans at Hopkins: Carol Gray, Sue Donaldson, and Martha Hill. And then that's me, with a blank space, and people will follow. I'm thankful and grateful to each and every one of you. I am so proud to be a nurse. I'm so proud to be able to go to my next position, being a nurse, to having an even bigger checkbook, and to really being able to advocate for the things that matter. So I thank each and every one of you for your kindness and generosity to me. I've learned so much about myself. I've learned so much about Baltimore. I will forever love Baltimore. I've said to two people today, I've got a serious dose of FOMO, fear of missing out. I see all the great things that are happening, but I will be watching from afar, and I will do everything I can to support each and every one of you, to support Hopkins Nursing. And I seriously think this is the most incredible place on the planet for healthcare. And I just feel that I have been exceptionally fortunate to be on the team for a short period of time, but I'm exceptionally proud to be part of the legacy of this institution. And so in American football style, I hand off to the next leadership, but I know we are in a great place. The future is really bright. The challenges are daunting, but it is in our DNA, is strength, tenacity, and looking to the world as not just being about us, but being about them. So thank you so much for the opportunity to speak to you. And I really look forward to some conversation, and I will truly miss everybody. But remember, I'm only a Zoom call away. Thank you.
So there's a large applause going on. If you can't hear it, Trish, lots of wonderful comments starting to come up on the screen. And you just, as expected, blew us all away. I don't think you need to fear FOMO. I don't think any of us are going to truly let you go, no matter how far in miles you are away. And yes, handoffs are a new term to me too, but you did a superb job in the context of handing over the charge for team health, team science, team learning. And you make us very proud to carry on your legacy. And I'd be delighted if people would start monitoring. I know Diana's going to help us with any questions or comments that are starting to jump up in the chat box. And Rafe, can we unmute folks if they'd like to talk?
Yes, anyone can unmute if they want to.
Okay, so there's an outpouring of gratitude in the chat box. It's just moving very quickly. And what I could say is most people are just saying that this has been a phenomenal handoff. People are saying, thank you, wonderful. They're so grateful, Trish, and a new thought inspired by your talk, heart, head, spirit, and has way more potential. So it's going quite quickly. So if there are I'm just seeing the same themes of inspiration and gratefulness. And I feel like we all feel the same way. Someone said, Patty says, Trish, you are a dynamic leader and will truly be missed. Cynthia Walters says, thank you, Dean Davidson, for making a big difference. Laura Arthur says, thank you for being such an engaged, approachable, inspirational, and student-centered leader. I mean, that is also true. We all know that's who you are. Rita Dow says, thank you for your leadership, vision, and compassion. Rebecca Wright says, oh, boss, no words, just thank you.
a couple of hands up.
Okay.
Ken would like to say something.
Okay, so yeah, we'll go ahead and welcome some comments, please, Ken.
Trish, thank you very much for your leadership. And I do have a question. There's a tradition when presidents change that the outgoing president leaves a letter in the drawer for the incoming president. Could you give us a little insight into what that message might be for the incoming president, Dean?
I would say, believe in yourself and just keep your ears open. And can I tell you, some days were really hard for me in the beginning. And I would come in the mornings and I would hear Officer Mobley laugh. And then he would probably say, you know, oh, hello, young lady. So I'd always have a chuckle. And then just walking around the corner to hear the engaged. I just think you can't be in a place like Hopkins without being motivated and inspired. And surround yourself with people that are smarter than you. That's my, if anyone really wants to know the secret to success, that's what it is. You surround yourself with people that are smarter than you, not people who are the same. And this is another aspect of diversity. It's about, you know, who's going to complement you, who's going to be the team. And I just think, and so maybe, you know, and the handoff. I knew nothing about American football till today, but now I know what a handoff is. Thank you, Kim.
Thank you. If anyone can unmute themselves and speak if you'd like.
We know this is not a shy group, so
yeah.
How about Michelle, you ask your question.
Okay, so Michelle's question is, Trish, how would you recommend we as nurses best prepare ourselves to be the most effective in policy and board positions?
So part of it is starting off believing in yourself. And, you know, and I just think we don't necessarily do a great job in terms of building confidence. And, you know, so I just think, you know, I've been thinking a lot about that. It's confident. Look, I tell you, I'm often scared. I was nervous today. I'm going to this huge job. And can I tell you, this is a true story. In the press release, they wrote something about my financial acumen. So my sister calls me, who is a corporate treasurer. And she said, where did they get that about your financial acumen? Because she thinks I'm totally hopeless with money, a total spendthrift. And so things like that make me anxious. But, you know, the thing is, you look and see what are your strengths, what are your knowledge, skills and competencies, and what do you have to offer? And can I tell you that article in Forbes, I keep thinking about that. I think there's so much that we teach in nursing in both the formal and hidden curriculum that manifests, and yet we don't tap into that. We don't tap into this, that we are generating this amazing, you know, cadre of people who are smart and kind and ethical and empathetic. And as the world changes, that is going to be much more powerful than whether you could do calculus. It's going to be those, I don't call them soft skills, I call them essential skills. So empathy, consideration, compassion, they are essential skills. And I really think we do a great job in nursing in doing that. So that's just what I would think. And just don't be daunted by the people that come out thinking they're a world expert. But on the other hand, don't let your vulnerability show too much. Just take a big deep breath and, you know, and go and do your best.
Thank you, Dean Davidson. We have two hands up. I don't know which one was first, but I'll go with who's first on my screen, and that's Dr. Harahan.
Actually, I think it's Nancy who raised a hand.
Okay, thank you.
Yes.
I would yield to you, Hera, but let me just ask quickly. Dean Davidson, will you tell us a little bit about the University of Wollongong and what this looks like for the next year for you?
So it's really scary. Tom Hall has offered to give me a low interest loan because the School of Nursing is in a much better financial position than it is. But, you know, one of the things, like, even though I went to school there, like, that's 40 years, that's a long time ago. What I really love is the value alignment. I love that each business unit reports on the sustainable development goals, whereas many other places you would go and people would say, what is that? And Wollongong is a lot like Baltimore. It was a big steel city. There used to be 30,000 people working in steelwork. Now that's about 1,000. The university is an anchor institution. So I just sort of feel an alignment. But there's 34,000 students. And even though Australia has done really well in COVID, the second highest contributor to the Australian GDP is international education. So as you can imagine, this has just been a devastating year. But you're all, I'd love you all to come visit. And I think there's a lot to learn about universal healthcare coverage. And it's hard to speak as a foreigner because, look, Hopkins is an amazing place. And I think if I'd have been here 10 years earlier, I just think I would have done so much more. But there's something about that sense of community and society. And it's not to say we don't have crazy people and right wing, but you've just seen what's happened in COVID where people just say, okay, I'm doing it. I'm going back. When I go back, I go into government quarantine, you know, for 2 weeks. And that's just the way the country has come. So, and we also see with Jacinda Ardern. So I'm hoping for better financial times, but yeah. But you know what you've done, Nancy, is a, you know, there are so many people here that have just done phenomenal things, you know. You know, Pigs for Peace, Rabbits for Resilience, and now a butcher shop. Pretty amazing things. And you know, Hara, what you've done with communities, there's just, you know, this is a very special place. And even one of the vice chancellors from Queensland University of Technology, she said to me, just prepare yourself. You're really gonna miss it. And I know I'm really gonna miss the vibrancy. For the students, I have never struck students like at Hopkins. Seriously, I've been at many places. The students are just truly phenomenal. And so there's going to be a lot I will miss.
Trish, I think you're setting this amazing role model for many of us. And I was reflecting on your professional career the other day for you, whether you believe it or not, but it was just, you know, so surreal to think about you coming from Australia to the United States to become a dean. And now you're going back to your home country to become a vice chancellor. What is waiting for you? I mean, do you have any idea what your roles are going to be like? And then if anything comes after this?
No, I'm definitely, you know, this is, this will be my swan song, but the vice chancellor is like a president's role. So it's a big university. There's four campuses in Australia. There's a campus in Dubai, Malaysia, and Hong Kong. So I will kind of have to kind of make money, fundraise, and just create a great, I hope, substrate for people to thrive. I think the big everybody, and I know is very true here in the US as well, is we need to make sure that there is a future for early career researchers and academics. I think this is kind of crazy, just the timing, and there is no end of, money is not endless. So I can't, yeah, so that will be my priority, is to create things. And I'm really hoping to do a lot in Indigenous health, and hopefully I'll get Teresa Brockie to come and do great work there, because we have an equally deplorable outcomes in Indigenous Australia. So, yeah, but I think that will be me. But, you know, it's just to show you, and I always think about Michelle Obama's book. When someone asked her about being first lady or something, no one told me I could. So I'm telling all of you, you can do anything that you want. The skill set that you have is pretty phenomenal. And there's no reason that you can't be, you know, a chair of a Fortune 500 company, or you can't be a CNO, or you can't set up your own NGO if that's what you want. And I really think in nursing, a lot of our positioning is related to gender, and we have to overcome that somehow. But that means addressing gender issues more broadly in society. And even Nancy Reynolds will tell you, I'm kind of sometimes with the WHO a bit on the fence, because they see the State of the World's Nursing Report about economic empowerment, get women out working. Well, yeah, that works if women are in well-paid jobs, not just, you know, on marginal incomes and not being at decision-making tables.
Thank you. So I'll go back to the chat for a moment just to catch up. Just wanted to say that Ken Dion stated in the chat, he said, Trish will get to fill her favorite role, grandmother. So, and And Jeff Pratt writes, on behalf of all of our friends at United Way Central Maryland, thank you, Trish, for being a true leader, supporter, and advocate for health, safety, and quality of life for our neighbors in need. You will be missed. We look forward to visiting you in Australia. And that's from Jeff Pratt on behalf of United Way of Central Maryland. Also, Rebecca Wright has a question, and she states, what would you want your legacy with us as stakeholders to be? The mark that you want to leave, the direction that you have set for the school moving on?
Well, you know, I just want everyone to be happy and successful, because if you are happy and feel successful, then your dean and I will be happy and successful. You know, I often, you know, and you've heard me say it before, I see people like Kathy Kushner-Reese and Sherry Lynn, and they are just so, they're happy where they are at. They're incredibly successful where they're at. And they don't begrudge anyone anything. And that's good. Not everybody has to be the dean. Not everybody needs to be, you know, an R01 does not define you as a person. So I think just being happy and successful and where you are in your life. And Ken, you know, I think, thanks for mentioning grandmother. You know, as a woman, you have to sometimes pace your career. You can have everything you can't have everything you want all at the same time. You know, my mother told me that when I was 3. But, you know, that is the richness of nursing career, that you can transform 100 times.
Thank you. So, I'm sorry.
And the direction, you know, I really want the world to know how smart nurses are. And how kind nurses are. Everyone talks about us being kind, but not so much about being smart. Now, you don't get out of an ICU in COVID without being smart. You don't run a community vaccination program in aged care housing without being smart. You don't run school programs without being smart. So part of this is this feminized, we have to keep the best... Yeah. Things of our feminization that has been collaborative, engaging, but we have to sort of believe in ourselves a whole lot more.
Thank you, Dean Davidson. I'll read two more comments from the chat, and then we have a hand up from one of our DMP students, Rena. So first I'll talk about what Colleen King says, the students will miss you too. Thank you for consideration of us and everything you do. Elizabeth Hood says, dear Dean Davidson, I have learned more about leadership in watching and hearing you than I have in a decade of formal leadership. You are a compassionate, thoughtful, insightful person, and I deeply appreciate your example. Thank you for your time and consideration. Diego, one of our MEN students, mentioned that he agrees that Professors Kathy Kushner-Reese and Lynn are a gift to nursing students. Every nursing student is so lucky to have them in Foundations of Nursing. I totally agree. I've had the opportunity to work with them. They're just fabulous. And so Beth Sloan says, so true that nursing is a flexible career. So very happy for you that you will see your granddaughter more often. Grandparenting is as good as it's cracked up to be. And she says, P.S., you'll be missed. So with that being said, we'll go ahead to Rena, has her hand up. And then when Rena is done, we'll go to Eric Reno, for questions.
Dan Davidson, again, I know previously I just said how much I admire your leadership, even in this short time I've been in the DMP program at Hopkins. I have lots of dream in helping advance nursing as I, you know, enter this DMP program. My question is, what advice would you give a student like me on how to fulfill my dreams in impacting nursing and population health as a whole, especially as it applies to underserved populations?
Yeah, look, I think coming back to the notion of a team, you can't do anything on your own. And I really think you need to seek supportive and enabling environments. So I think you want to work in an organization that will support you to be the very best you can be. And that doesn't, and so it's okay to move. It's okay to move. I've moved and it's been okay for me. You know, this notion of I've got to stay here X number of years. Winston Churchill said, when the going gets tough, the tough get going. You know, it's just you have to move till you get somewhere that is really going to support you. And when you're looking for that job, make sure that you have value alignment with the organization and with the leadership. Because if you don't have value alignment, your life will be a misery. So, you know, don't believe the, you know, we all say the mission and vision statement. No one has a mission statement, you know, I want to be the fourth institution. So you really want to, I say, look under the hood and see before you go so that you have value alignment.
Thank you.
So I'm just reading Tiffany's comment, which is true. Tiffany said, and lovely to see you, Tiffany. You know, I did a research leadership course once, and they said to be successful, you don't have to be smart and work hard. You need a bit of the mongrel dog in you. And that is like an Australian street dog. So you need the street smarts. You need to be political, you know. And people say that healthcare is not political and you can't be political. That is the greatest mistake. Politics can be different to partisan policy. Just see what's happening over gun control. We've all got to step up about this, particularly in our city. In fact, one of our staff members just today, one of their cousin was shot. You know, that is just, you know, not in the richest country in the world, you know, that can put a man on the moon, a vehicle on Mars, with all these smart people. We've got to get better at some of these issues. And another quote that I often use is from Letitia O'Donoghue, who is a national living legend, an Indigenous nurse in Australia, and she has a saying, socially created problems can be likely socially transformed. And that is where I really think is the sweet spot for, you know, not just nursing, but healthcare in the communities and public health.
Thank you. Eric, did you want to speak?
Oh, yeah. It's more so just a comment, Dean Davidson. I in my short first semester here, you have honestly tremendously like inspired me to do more in nursing. At first, I thought I wanted to do research, and hearing you speak about leadership, policy making, and everything that nurses can do in the future just inspires me so much. And I wanted you to know that, because part of me is sad that my cohort won't get to work with you more, because we had one semester with you. But also really, really, really tremendously grateful that, you know, I got to hear you speak and choose Hopkins during my beginning of my nursing career.
Well, thank you for choosing Hopkins, and you have to come visit me in Australia.
Most definitely. If there are any additional comments or questions, please feel free to either raise your hand or unmute and speak. Or if you're shy, you can put something in the chat and we'll have Dean Davidson address it.
I think we might have dried up because either people are tearful or there's just sometimes there's more to say than you possibly can, you know, and I think we may have reached that point. But speak up now. We'll keep going for one more minute. And in that time, it's so hard to thank you for everything, Dean Davidson. I would agree with Elizabeth Hood when she talked about how much wisdom you've imparted, and I've held leadership positions and colleagues working with you then in a very long career. So everyone wants to wish you and Michael and your family well. And thank you for making sure that we all keep a little bit of that Australian mongrel in us.
No, it's good. It's a good way to be. Because I'm far from perfect. Marie, you know, the other thing is, you know, just having a great leadership team, you know, around us has just been phenomenal. And, you know, so many people on the leadership team, you know, have just been phenomenal. And Marie has just been such a good balance for me. But sometimes she'll say, Trish, I don't think I'd say that. But she kind of buffers the mongrel dog a bit.
Well, I think we'll bring this to, you know, a very grateful close, and for teaching us all so much. And we wish you so, so well in Australia. And we also know that this is not goodbye. But thank you for honoring us with the virtual Grand Round series. And of course, this was your idea in the very first place.
Yep.
And so that was a handover right there. It's like Nikki and Diana take this and run with it, and Katie, of course. So
right.
That's leadership right there. So thank you. Thank you to everybody for joining us.
Thank you.
It has been recorded and it will be available. So I'm sure many of us will want to view it many times. And thank you most especially to Dean Davidson.
Thank you. Thank you so much, everybody. And you are in my heart forever. And you'll be surprised how much I will be shouting out for you behind the scenes.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. And just a reminder, we will be sending out a link for evaluation. For those who complete the link, you will receive 1.0 contact hour, continuing education hour for attending this event. Thank you, everyone.